If you're new to Airtable, or if you just need a refresher about all of the different features and how to build what you want with this tool, well, look no further, because this video is all about helping you get started with Airtable in 2025. That's right, this is a current version of this idea, updated for 2025 with the current features in play. So if learning more about how you can get started in Airtable is of interest to you, stick around and let's get into it. Welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth and this is Gap Consulting. It's our mission here to help you escape spreadsheets and embrace no-code tools like Airtable. In this video, as I said, we're going to be taking a look at the beginner's view of Airtable. What do you need to know if this software was just dropped off in your lap? We're going to be talking about this from a very high level, but I do want to let you know that if you want to go deeper on any of the topics that we cover here, this channel has covered Airtable for years, and you can definitely find a video diving deeper on specific topics if you poke around in our playlists. All right, before we get into the heart of the video, I first want to invite you to join me for some templates. At Gap Consulting, we built 5 Airtable templates to help you really embrace no code. So if you're new to this, this is a perfect place to start. Each template we built is accompanied by its own video to help you get up and running quickly and give you ideas on how you can automate your work with the template. So go ahead and sign up for those free templates at gapconsulting.io/templates. But without further ado, we're gonna hop on into my screen and take a look at Airtable. And I do wanna also let you know that we are gonna be working from one of our templates. This is the invoice and payment tracking template that you can download for free at the link I provided earlier. So if you wanna follow along with us, I welcome you to do that. Go ahead and open up the free template on your own and follow along with this video. Now here we are inside, and I first wanna draw our attention to the very top bar. Right here, we've got 4 different options, and these are truly the building blocks of Airtable. And really, each one of these pieces has its own purpose and own functions within Airtable. And so, depending on what your role is within your organization, you might use one of these, you might use all 4 of these. It really depends on if you are actively building Airtable solutions for your team, or alternatively, you could just be accessing a solution that somebody else built. So let's rewind just a little bit here and just kind of talk about Airtable at a high level. Airtable allows you to build your own apps without the need of any code, which means that you could be just somebody who's using that app to do your job, or you could be the person building the app. Now, it really depends. If you're the person in your organization who's embracing Airtable and is like building these solutions and deploying them to different people on your team, well, then you're going to be needing all 4 of these things. If not, that's fine. You're going to be focused on interfaces, and we'll go into this as well in this video. But let's talk about these 4 different components at a high level. So first, we've got data. Data is where Airtable really started, right? This is the first piece of Airtable, and these other pieces have kind of come along as Airtable has grown and expanded its reach. But really, what Airtable is, it's a place for you to store information. It's like a spreadsheet, but it's better because it's a database, which means that you can connect things across your different tables. Whereas a spreadsheet is really just a bunch of rows and columns, Airtable really treats your data more like a database, a traditional database would. And so here in our example, this is the data section of Airtable. And each of these tabs up here, clients, invoices, line items, and services, each of these reflects a data set inside of our app. And so effectively, you know, this app, as you would guess by the name, it's all about invoicing and tracking payments within an organization. So it makes sense that we would connect to clients, right? Because we're not going to send an invoice to nobody. And so clients are a component of this, but they live in their own area, their own table. You can think of this as a list of clients. Then, of course, another component of this is going to be the invoice itself. And so these invoices, again, are going to be on a different table, a different list of data. But the important thing here is you can see that it's connected to the client. And this is where a database beats a spreadsheet every time, because now we don't have to have redundant data, because we know everything there is to know about this client. We've connected to the client right here. So the invoice links to the client. Now, it's also going to link to other things as well. So if we scroll over, you'll see that it links to line items here as well. And that's the next section that we're going to look at. That's the third different table in this particular Airtable demo. And then lastly, we have our services. These are the different services that we offer. And so you can understand how we would create different lists and then get them connected. They're all connected within our database solution. And this is what happens here in the data component of Airtable. Now, if you are an Airtable builder for your organization, then you are going to live here. You're going to do a lot of work in the database back end. And that's where you're building different things like adding fields like service price. You're going to add new tables by bringing in tables either from a spreadsheet or just starting them from scratch. You're going to learn how to link tables so that all of your tables and all of your data are connected and talking to each other. This is going to be where most Airtable builders spend a lot of their time. Now, the next place over here is automations. Automations are magic. Now, if you've never built automation with any kind of software before, don't let it overwhelm you. It's actually quite simple to do. Now, depending on your Airtable plan, you may get more or less automation for your database. I would strongly recommend that you check out Airtable's pricing page to figure out whatever their current pricing is, because they do change their pricing and what's included in the different plans every so often. Now, what are automations? Well, Airtable has native automations here inside the software that allow us to take action either in our Airtable database or, in some cases, using third-party software as well that Airtable is already integrated with. Let's take a quick example so we can see what types of things are possible with automation. So maybe we do something at a scheduled time. We can say, hey, at a scheduled time, we want to build an automation that triggers on some sort of schedule, and we can choose what that interval is. Maybe it's every week. We could say every Monday at 11 a.m., and we would say every 1 week. So very simply, just by selecting some different things from a dropdown here, I've set up a trigger that says, hey, every week on Monday at 11 a.m. my time, I want to have this automation run. And then the next parts that we build are the actual action steps of the automation. So let's take a look at the different options here. So we can do things within Airtable. So for example, we can find records, we can then update those records, we can create new records. So a lot of stuff inside of Airtable itself. If you're going to get a little more advanced, we also have the ability to generate processes with AI, and we can also run scripts. So these things really unlock even more potential for you. They're slightly on the more advanced side. If you're brand new to automation, I wouldn't start here. And you'll also notice that they require that you're on the team plan. So you cannot do this on a free Airtable plan. Team plan, though, and above will be fine. You can use these more advanced features. But it's not only actions in Airtable. We also have third-party integrations. So you can send a message to Slack or Microsoft Teams. You can send an email via automation. You can create or update events in Google Calendar. So you see, you've got quite a long list of things that you can do here, things that you can interact with from Airtable automations. And this allows you to use data that exists inside of your Airtable database and then automate those repetitive tasks that you do day in and day out. And they're going to be automated here in the background, running on autopilot so that they're not sucking up your mental bandwidth anymore. Now, I do want to also point out that Airtable's integrations, the native integrations here, are somewhat limited, but automation potential is actually quite robust. You can connect using third-party tools to your Airtable data and take even more advanced automations and really ramp this up to the next level. I'm talking about creating PDFs, sending documents for signature, talking to your accounting software. All kinds of different things are possible using automation, and not all of that automation is going to be available here inside of Airtable. So if you're looking for a third-party solution, we recommend Zapier and Make.com as two of the most common automation tools that can integrate with Airtable. Bear in mind, those are different tools, but they will talk to your Airtable and help connect Airtable to other things that you use in your organization. Now, the third component here is interfaces. And if you are not a builder inside of Airtable, well, then you're going to do a lot of your time here in interfaces. I mean, most of the time, what we're doing in an interface is launching that app to people, and we cultivate what the experience looks like so that when they access the app, they're accessing the interface. You know, if we go back to the previous page here, and we're looking at the data structure, you know, this is rows and columns. Most people don't like looking at spreadsheets, right? If you're in an interface though, you can really customize the look and feel of it, and you can control who sees what and what they are allowed to edit. So not only can you control if they can see something, you can also control what they can change or update. And this level of granular permissions allows you to really take things to the next level when you share your apps with your team. So let's take a look here. We've got clients, we've got invoices, we've got services, and you can see that each one of these interfaces kind of starts with this overview page. This is how I prefer to build them, but you don't have to. But look at all the different options we have. This is a gallery. And if we had actual pictures here, then each of these clients would show up in this gallery with their image. Here's invoices. We can drop into the invoice detail, flip through the different invoices. Some are paid, some are overdue. We can look at all of our invoices. We can go to our payments dashboard and check out some high-level metrics for the company. You know, how are we getting paid? Are things in various statuses? We can look at all of this here in interfaces. So this is where you're going to probably do the majority of your work, unless you're the person who's building the actual Airtable itself. But the important thing to understand is that an interface is simply a window to look at the data that lives on the back end. So all of this is really driven by the data that's back here, and we can get there by going to view data. Now, I do want to point out that you can share access with just an interface, or you can share access to the whole database. So if you are here in the data and you share, then you're going to be sharing with everybody. Like, you're giving them the keys to the kingdom. That's really important to know. On the other hand, if you're in an interface and you click share down here in the bottom left, now you can share with specific people and they will only see the interface that you share with them. And that is really taking things to the next level for you in terms of controlling your data, your permissions, etc. Now, the fourth and final component of Airtable, it's kind of an oldie. It's been around for a while, and they've only just recently broken it out to be its fourth component, and it's forms. Now, let's talk about what a form is, right? It allows us to build a form that can be public-facing, that allows other people to enter data that will be put into our database. So really all it is a way of receiving data. And typically what we see is a lot of integration and automation when it comes to bringing data into your database. For example, maybe you have an invoice that gets paid in Stripe. When that invoice gets paid, remember back to automations when we were talking about that, you could have an automation built in Zapier or Make that says, hey, a new invoice was paid. I'm going to create a transaction record in the database. That's all very possible. And most of our clients are using some sort of automation to keep their data in their apps up to date at all times. However, not all the time do you require an integration. Sometimes the information is a little simpler. It could be like an inquiry form or people filling out a contact form. Now, all kinds of forms are possible. It doesn't have to just be something that you put on your website, but that is what the form component allows for you to do. It's basically saying, hey, build this form, add whatever fields you would like. You can rearrange them a little bit. You can make certain things required and other things not required. You can hide certain things. I mean, it's basically a form builder. And the nice thing about using the Airtable form here in particular is that it directly integrates with Airtable and you don't have to build the automation part. So if I were to build, let's say, a new client's form, I could ask for the client name, the billing contact name, and the billing contact email and phone number. I could keep it simple. And then as soon as people started filling information out and submitting, it would automatically create records in my database. I don't have to build the automation. I don't have to build the integration. So this function then really unlocks true power for you to have others filling information out to keep your data up to date. But I do want to point out that Airtable forms are somewhat limited. They're pretty powerful, yes, but Airtable is not a form tool first and foremost. It's an app building tool. It's a database tool. So if you're looking for more robust forms with things like schedules or linked relationships or conditionally visible things, these are more advanced functions, and I would recommend heading over to a true form software because the limitations of Airtable's forms are still, you know, prevalent. It's a great starting point, but for those more advanced needs, we tend to go to third-party form tools. Namely, Fillout is the one that we currently recommend the most. It integrates beautifully with Airtable and has a very reasonable pricing. And so if you're going really deep in your apps, using Fillout is maybe something you would consider. But do know that you have the native forms here in Airtable, and they work pretty well for most basic needs. Now, I know we went pretty quickly in this video. There's a lot to cover, but as I said at the beginning, if you want to do a deep dive on any of the topics that we glazed over here, go and check out the different things in our Airtable playlists. We've been making these videos for quite a while, and we probably have a resource out there that can help you do what you're looking to do. I hope you got a ton of value from this video. If you did, be sure to subscribe to the channel, give us a thumbs up, and of course, swing by our website if you need some more advanced help. But most importantly, keep on building.